These samples by Andrei Gema and Kostya Novoselov. Okay. It doesn't work anywhere. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hmm?
Records you.
Ah, it's records. Okay. Okay, so this outline of my talk. So how to fix it. After short introduction, I will present direct measurements of spontaneous coherence and condensation of excitons by shift interferometry. Then I will present phenomena which are observed in exciton condensate and only in exciton condensate. We are not observed above critical temperature. This includes commensurability effect, spin currents and spin textures, and Pancharatnam-Berry phase in exciton condensate. And then I will introduce some kind of excitonic devices. I will present condensation of excitons in a trap, then vocalization-devocalization transition of excitons in lattices, and random potentials. Then I will introduce exciton correlations, and actually all topics here are coupled. In particular, exciton correlations are needed to describe condensation and transition in lattices. And finally, I will present indirect exciton and van der Waals heterostructures. So recently we observed indirect excitons at room temperature. I will tell a few words about that. So presenting excitonic devices. So we do all this like transistors, CCD, memory cells, diodes, everything what people do with electrons, we also do with excitons. And then the realization of high magnetic field regime, very similar to what Manfred just told us, and we study transport of particles in this high magnetic field regime. Okay, so first an introduction. So we already know what an exciton is, a bound pair of an electron and a semiconductor, very similar to hydrogen atom. So now we are, in this particular presentation, interested in so-called cold exciton gas. So this is like a regular definition of a cold gas. Okay, so regular definition of a cold gas. So we will call a gas cold when thermal de Broglie wavelength is comparable to separation between particles. Like for bosons, this definition is close to the definition of Bose-Einstein condensation. For fermions, it's a quantum degenerate Fermi gas. Like this takes place when below the temperature of quantum degeneracy. Like for two-dimensional system, if I write this sentence in terms of the equation, I see that this takes place below this temperature of quantum degeneracy. Now if I take gallium arsenide sample, which will be used in most of this presentation, only at the end I will switch to TMD samples. For gallium arsenide samples, if I plug the mass of exciton in our samples and typical density, of course we can control density, but typical density is like that, then we see that temperature of quantum degeneracy is on the order of few Kelvin. And this is very close to temperature Bose-Einstein condensation. It takes place somehow below this temperature of quantum degeneracy. So it looks like it's easy to realize this temperature. For example, in our lab we use optical dilution refrigerator, and the temperature which we achieve, including all this radiation coming from the room and from the laser, all together we realize temperature of 30 millikelvin. We call this heating. So it's much smaller than this temperature, like 100 times smaller. So it looks like it's easy to realize quantum degeneracy. However, it's not very easy, in particular because excitons can recombine. An electron can recombine with a hole, transform to a photon. So this takes finite lifetime. And this lifetime may not be enough to cool down to these temperatures. And this is what usually happens for excitons in semiconductors. They stay hot. So this is the idea why we study indirect excitons. We grow a couple of quantum wells, make separation between them relatively small, typically 10 nanometers. Then we apply bias, not necessarily. In some samples, bias is not required. So then an electron is confined in one quantum well, a hole is confined in another quantum well. So this way we suppress recombination of electrons as we wish. Like we easily make lifetime, like regular lifetime of exciton, of direct exciton in single quantum well is like 30 picoseconds in gallium arsenide. But after this separation, we do it as we wish. So we can go even to milliseconds. But typically we select lifetime on the order of 100 nanoseconds, it's simply more convenient for experiments. So and when we have these spatially indirect excitons, binding energy drops only a little bit, typically by 2 times. Separation is relatively small, but lifetime increases by many orders of magnitude. And when we have these indirect excitons, we have very long lifetime. So let's see what happens if we inject excitons hot, let's say by optical excitation, and then we wait when we cool down, and when typically just emitting phonons, releasing energy to the lattice, exciton cool down to 100 millikelvin, roughly in 100 nanoseconds. So, and this is why roughly 100 nanoseconds is our favorite lifetime. Of course, we can make it even 1,000 times longer, and we do, we make it 1,000 times longer, but this is not needed. Because already with this lifetime, excitons cool down 2 orders of magnitude below temperature of quantum degeneracy. So we easily realize ultra-cold exciton gas with temperatures well below temperature of Bose-Einstein condensation, and then we just study phenomena in this ultra-cold exciton gas. Yes, this is why we see Bose-Einstein condensation, because we really thermalize. Now, first, direct measurements of Bose-Einstein condensation. So, of course, we have many phenomena which signals Bose-Einstein condensation. So, first started more than 2 decades ago, but we need some direct measurements which are free from interpretation. And this is one of these direct measurements. It's presented here. So, we measure coherence of emitted light. So the advantage of excitons is that an exciton completely transforms to a photon. Like in contrast to atoms, when an atom emits light, then you have recoil atom behind. So therefore, for indirect excitons or any excitons, emitted photons convey all information about excitons. Like everything is conserved. Momentum, energy, phase, everything is conserved. This is why studying coherence of photons, we know information about coherence of excitons. Okay, now what we do? So our sample with these indirect excitons is in the optical dilution refrigerator at low temperatures together with objective. So this is also important to put objective inside. So this makes everything stable. Then the signal is collected, sent to Mach Zehnder interferometer. Each arm of the interferometer forms an image. And then we just shift these 2 images relative to each other in plane. So this way, light emitted by exciton in point A interferes with light emitted by exciton in point B. And when we just separate these points A and B and see how the contrast of interference fringes drops with separation. So this way we directly measure first order coherence function. Amplitude of interference fringes is just first order coherence function as a function of this separation. So when separation is zero, of course, any source is absolutely coherent, both classical or condensate. So then contrast of interference fringes is maximum. But for a classical gas, when you increase separation, contrast of interference fringes drops quickly within thermal de Broglie wavelength. So in our experiment at our temperatures, it's smaller than 0.3 micrometers, very small. So what you measure in the experiment is convolution of this first-order coherence function with the point spread function of your optics. In our case, we have resolution about 1.4 micrometers, so we must observe something like that for a classical gas. So this width coherence length then is equal to this point spread function width, which is simply resolution of our objective, and these are simply area rings due to the objective. And this is exactly what we observed at higher temperatures. At higher temperatures, we see exactly what we should observe for a classical gas. Yes?
Point spread function of the microscope is larger than the interference, and would you expect the contrast to start below one?
No, it just starts from here. And this is exactly actually what is observed in the experiment. It actually works opposite. Everything which is within coherent lengths looks coherent, even if it is not. Everything within resolution of the objective, it looks coherent, even if it is not coherent. So this is as usual, when you make convolution weak of real first order coherence function, weak point spread function, this is what you observe. Like everything looks coherent within resolution of your objective. Okay, so now this is for classical gas, and what is expected for classical gas is exactly observed in the experiment. So which means what everything works as it should work. Now, if we have a condensate, then coherence length strongly increases. In our experiments, this increases by roughly up to 100 times. So we achieve coherence length on the order of 10 micrometers. And this is what exactly is observed in the experiment. So we see this first order coherence function, which corresponds to a nice condensate. The coherence length, something like roughly 50 to 100 times larger than coherence length, which can be achieved in a classical gas. And then, as I mentioned, so what we essentially measure in the experiment is spontaneous coherence, the coherence length much larger than it can be achieved in a classical gas. So in terms of matter wave functions, if we are talking about this phenomenon in real space, we are talking about spontaneous coherence of exciton matter waves. If we want to switch to language of momentum, then we should talk in the terms of condensation in momentum space. But of course, these are two languages to describe one and the same phenomenon. Mathematically, this just is expressed by this expression, like first order coherence function, which is plotted here, is just a Fourier transform of distribution of particles in momentum space. So there is no interpretation involved. These are just two expressions for one and the same phenomenon. So here, if we just take Fourier transform of the measurements, we obtain what for at high temperatures, it's just Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, as it should be. At low temperatures, we see a nice condensate, which we spread in momentum space, roughly 50 to 100 times smaller than for a classical gas. So both in absolute units, in terms of the coherence length, and in relative units, in terms of how many thermal de Broglie wavelengths, this is comparable to Bosenstein condensates of atoms. So we have coherence length on the order of 10 microns, and this is roughly like 50 times more than thermal de Broglie wavelength. Question? I will show later everything. Just using this Fourier transform. You don't need. You just take this G1, which is amplitude of interference fringes, you make Fourier transform, you obtain distribution momentum space. I will talk about phase a little bit later. It does. I will tell about this in half an hour. Okay, so next, just where condensate is observed and where condensate is not observed. So first we have a source. This is intensity of emitted light around the source. So excitons after excitation go away from this source. And now this is pattern of interference fringes around this source. At high temperature, we still see interference fringes. So it's actually nice. We have kind of a reference even at higher temperatures. You see even for a classical gas, we have finite contrast of interference fringes. So this color represents just amplitude of interference fringes, and this is cross-section through the center, and you see everywhere we have small amplitude of interference fringes, which corresponds to a classical gas. If now we go to low temperatures, in this experiment 100 millikelvin, then at the center, close to the excitation spot, we still have a classical gas with low amplitude of interference fringes. So this is due to the heating. At the heating source, excitons are heated by the excitation. So, but when, as soon as excitons go away, roughly 5 microns away from the center, we cool down, and at some point we achieve critical temperature for condensation, then coherence sharply emerges. And this is really sharp phase transition, as sharp as we can see. This is just sharpness is special resolution of our experiments. Within 1 micron, we see coherence sharply emerges. So this is more or less expected, and later I will present temperature dependence. It happens even at temperature where it is expected. It's not a big surprise. Condensation was expected at some temperature, and it was observed directly at this same temperature where it was expected. But what was not expected, it was these events in the spin system. So let me just tell a few words now, and then I will describe in details what's going on. So this picture shows a pattern of polarization. So it this is pattern of linear polarization. Yellow means horizontal, blue means vertical polarization of emitted light. At high temperature, zero polarization. What we see here is just noise around zero polarization. At low temperature, so in a classical gas, we see this is region of classical gas. We see this yellow ring, which means horizontal polarization. But as soon as we have transition from a classical gas to a condensate, you see polarization changes from yellow to blue, which means from horizontal to vertical. And what we have here, vertical, horizontal, we have a vortex of polarization. So as soon as we go from a classical gas to a condensate, we see transition from polarization ring to a vortex of polarization. And I will discuss, now it's all understood, I will discuss why it is so later. And just you mentioned what we face is important. Again, yes, it is important. I will come back to this issue in half an hour. These fringes at the top, so they are indeed observed. So here I need to mention this is shift interferometry at some fixed shift. And this shift was chosen 2 micrometers to be here. So it should be small amplitude of fringes at for a classical gas and a large amplitude for a condensate. So just convenient number. Of course, we measured it completely as a function of this shift to measure completely first order coherence function, but we just selected some special value of the shift. So immediately see where we have condensate and where we don't have condensate. Okay, so now I will come back to this issue of the phase. I will come back to polarization in 10 minutes, but let me now first overview where condensate is observed. So this is actually pattern formation, which we have in this system. I will not describe this phenomena. It's observed on the large macroscopic lengths. We see the rings. So this is 0.5 millimeter, a really big size. And above critical temperature, this ring is spatially homogeneous. But below critical temperature, it breaks into periodic array of these bright beads. Each of them contains large number of excitons, macroscopically large. We control it from 1,000 to 1,000,000. And then everything was understood long time ago, so it's, I will not tell about this. It was presented at earlier schools. But at that time, we claimed macroscopic spatial order on the length for like millimeter. So we called this state macroscopically ordered exciton state because it has macroscopic spatial order. Now I will show what it is also condensate in momentum state, momentum space. This is fragment of this external ring. You see these fragments, these beads, bright beads of excitons. Again, similar experiments to the previous. At higher temperature, we see no condensate. You see no spontaneous coherence. But when we cool below critical temperature, then we observe condensate. At the center, condensate is diluted, not to the zero. It is a condensate, but it's somehow diluted. Again, because it's source of excitons, which hits a little bit excitonic system. But as soon as excitons go a little bit away, condensate develops full strength. And again, this condensation is observed below critical temperature, same critical temperature where this ring fragments into periodic array of bright beads. Okay, so and same happens here, like for polarization. At higher temperature, no polarization of emitted light. Below critical temperature, periodic array of bright beads generates periodic polarization texture and associated periodic spin texture. I will tell about this in a couple of slides. But first of all, let me just add a few words about this macroscopically ordered state and coherence. So I will tell a few words about fluctuation and commensurability effect in this exciton density wave. So it appears that we can change the period of this ordered exciton state. So you have density wave for excitons. As I mentioned, in each period of this wavelength, you have like we have from 1,000 to 1,000,000 excitons, and it appears that we can change the period of this wave. So for the fixed location of the ring, we can change it, let's say, within like 3-4 times, from 7, let's say, micrometers up to, I don't know, 30 micrometers, roughly. Okay, so we change it by changing excitation power in the experiment. And now we can put some defects on the same ring, and now we have some number of wavelengths between defects. And we may have commensurability when we have integer number of wavelengths between defects, or it can be incommensurate when we have some non-integer number. And when we measure how stable is this wave, because we observe when we have integer number of wavelengths, let's say, what it is, 6 wavelengths, then the wave is stable. All these bits stay where we are. Or if we have 5 bits between defects, the wave is stable. But if we have something like pi 5.3, then wave is unstable. We simply see how all these bits fluctuate. So this commensurability effect is observed up to macroscopic lengths, like in this particular experiment, 200 microns. So this exciton density wave containing millions of excitons behave collectively. So the fact that commensurability length, the length where this commensurability is observed, is much larger than the wavelength of this density wave tells us that this effect is collective. So the fact that coherence length is much larger than thermal de Broglie wavelength tells us that it is a condensate in momentum space. And finally, we have periodic spatial order. So eventually, we have a state, which is Bose-Einstein condensate. It has macroscopic spatial order and has and it is a collective phenomenon. And this is a set of data, and by now everything is well understood. So like first Leonid Levitov and Ben Simons developed the theory back in 2005, even before we measured what is the Bose-Einstein condensate, but we immediately implied this in their theory. You see, now it's everything is confirmed. It is a Bose-Einstein condensate. And even this commensurability effect, it was confirmed by Ben Simons. It's in a good agreement with the theory. Like these fluctuations should be suppressed when we have integer number of wavelengths between defects. Okay, now let me go to these spin currents and spin textures. So I will try to explain this pattern of polarizations. So what do we have here? For excitons, excitons are, of course, composed of electrons and holes. An electron may have spin projection on the z direction plus 1/2 or minus 1/2. A hole may have projection plus 3/2 or minus 3/2. So this is just band structure of gallium arsenide. It may be more complicated, but fortunately for us, in quantum wells, hole spin structure is simple because white holes are far away in energy. Only these projections of holes are available, so which makes it more simple. So now, out of these combinations of electron and hole spins, we can compose 4 different excitons with total spin minus 1/2, plus 1/2, minus 1, plus 1, minus 2, and plus 2. So these excitons and these excitons are optically active. They can emit photons. So this exciton emits in sigma minus polarization, this exciton emits in sigma plus, and they are superposition in linear polarization. So these 2 excitons are optically dark. They cannot emit photons. But of course, all 4 different spin states are present for excitons. Now, if excitons is moving, we have spin-orbit interaction, and these 4 spin states are split. So this energy splitting is proportional to the momentum, so due to spin-orbit interaction. Then, for a condensate, there is coherent spin precession between these 4 different spin states. And when we plug this ballistic exciton transport, ballistic, which means no scattering, and we know what it is ballistic because everything is within coherence length, which we measure it is big. So it is transport of exciton without scattering. Scattering is suppressed, which is expected due to superfluidity. So it's ballistic transport and coherent spin precession. Then we reproduced this pattern in the experiments. It is important to have all four spin states in the coherent spin precession. You cannot say whether you have bright condensate or dark condensate. Everything is included. If you remove one state, you will not reproduce this. You need all four to be involved. So now, here it's an important point. Like, if we measure, we also measure it for non-condensed state spin transport. And it's a period that's very short. Due to the fast spin relaxation, mainly determined by Dyakonov-Pirel mechanism. So for non-condensed electrons or non-condensed excitons, or just simply for electrons, it's on the order of 1 micron. So very short spin coherent transport. For holes, it's even in nanometers, very short. But when excitons, but when electrons and holes bind into excitons and exciton condense, then we have huge enhancement of coherent spin transport length. Because in the condensate, scattering is suppressed due to superfluidity. So therefore, all mechanisms of spin relaxation related to scattering are also suppressed. So no Dyakonov-Pirel. Since no spin relaxation, we have huge spin transport distances. Like, I will show it's like low bound 10 microns, but in fact, we even cannot measure it. It goes as far as we see excitons. With coherent spin precession, I will show later. Yes. Here, it's totally symmetric, so it's just a vortex. This is simply like what we plot here is degree of linear polarization, Ix minus Iy. This is how we defined x. If we just rotate our analyzer, everything rotates. It's absolutely symmetric, of course. Okay, I will show later about coherent spin precession, but let me just show some nice figures. So here you see I mentioned spin orbit interaction and Zeeman effect. So which means what now I will switch on magnetic field and we will see how all of this changes. So this is from the previous slide. So this is just shows linear polarization. So green mean horizontal, blue vertical. You see vortex of linear polarization. This is how theorists, it's a group of Alexey Kavokin, simulate this pattern of linear polarization. So more or less reminiscent to the experiment. And later, so this was done for single particle. Like very simple ballistic transport and coherent spin precession. Later we updated this using Gross-Pitayevsky, so including interaction, it looks much more close to the experiment after that. But it's already this captures all physics. Now I will increase magnetic field step by step, each step 1 tesla. And you will see what everything rotates, both in the experiment and the theory. So you see now it starts to rotate. So both experiment and the theory. And now in place of this vortex of polarization, we have spiral pattern of polarization. And again, we do not change any parameters in the simulations, like we fit everything at zero magnetic field and when everything just follows. And this is, you may call it spin hole effect, like density transport of particles is different from their spin transport. So if you want, you may call it spin hole effect. And in contrast to regular spin hole effect, where people barely see on 1 micron, we see it on tens of microns and directly. Okay, so now let me just summarize this here. Like this is in linear polarization experiment when we increase magnetic field theory. We see transition from this helical vortex pattern at zero magnetic field to a spiral pattern in higher magnetic field. Of course, we also measure it in sigma polarization. It's exactly the same phenomenon, just measured in another polarization. At zero magnetic field, we have 4-leaf pattern, sigma plus, sigma minus, sigma plus, sigma minus. Same in theory. It's exactly the same theory with exactly the same fitting parameters. When we increase magnetic field, it transforms to bell-like reconversion, sigma plus surrounded by sigma minus, and also exactly reproduced by the same theory. And it's the same theory, just ballistic transport and coherent spin precession. So now let me come to the phase, and the phase we describe in terms of Pancharatnam-Berry phase. So question? Yes, yeah, I will talk about this right now. Yeah, so now Pancharatnambe phase. So far I analyzed amplitude of interference fringes. Now I will talk about phase of interference fringes. So first few words, just definition. What is Pancharatnambe phase? It is actually geometrical phase which appears when you change any set of parameters. Like first it was introduced by Pancharatnam. So when he studied polarization of light, and it appears when if you change polarization of light and arrive to exactly the same polarization, still you have some additional phase. And he made some elegant theory that the phase, if you plot this polarization of light on Poincaré sphere, then it's easy to calculate what phase is acquired. It's just equal to the half of the solid angle experiments. We directly measure phase by shift interferometry. Now, to identify phase, some other phase, we compare the polarization of light, and we identify what our change of phase occurs exactly when polarization changes. So this identifies what it's not just some phase, it is Pancharatnambe phase. And the significance is, as I will show, what this acquired Pancharatnambe phase demonstrate long-range coherent spin transport with coherent spin precession. This will be answer to your question. So now let me show this. So let me show again this picture. So this is again interference fringes. Now I will analyze this phase jump. You see, when we have transition from a classical gas to recondensate at the same location, we see jump of the phase of interference fringes. Now at the same location, we observe polarization change from yellow to blue, which means from horizontal to vertical. And we have perfect correlation between location of the formation of condensate, polarization jump, and phase jump. And this correlation actually tells us what this phase is, the Pancharatnambe phase. And we performed lots of experiments. So we studied for variety of excitation powers. And you see, if I change excitation power from here to here, location of phase changes a lot. But at the same time, we see location change for the polarization change and location change for condensation. But it always at the same position. Phase jump, condensation, and polarization jump. And we acquired lots of data for many different excitation powers, for many different light sources. And we have scattering of data everywhere. But if we plot location where polarization jumps versus location where phase jumps, all these scattered data collapse on the same universal line, which actually proves that the phase jump is always located at the polarization jumps, which proves what this phase is a Pancharatnambe phase. So now, of course, from the phase of interference fringes, we can easily extract the phase of excitons. And we can characterize this phase of excitons by momentum, which is associated with this Pancharatnambe phase. And this momentum from this phase pattern is plotted here. You see in the center, it's essentially zero. At some moment, we see this sharp enhancement of the phase. So we see this phase pattern. And actually, we, of course, instructed both kx and ky components of the momentum. So this is why you see these arrows, because we extracted both kx and ky. So we made shift in the x direction and shift in the y direction, which allowed us to extract both kx and ky. So we have a pattern of this momentum associated with Pancharatnambe phase. Okay, so what do we have here? So this is just Poincaré sphere. So what do we, if somebody is not familiar, it represents the polarization of light. So on the equator, you have linear polarization, like x corresponds to horizontal, so minus x corresponds to vertical, this corresponds to diagonal polarization, and the poles correspond to sigma plus and sigma minus polarization. So this, it's convenient geometrical object to represent any polarization of light. And as it was shown by Pancharatnam, when polarization state of light goes over this Poincaré sphere, make a cycle and returns to the same point, then the acquired phase is simply half of the solid angle made by this curve. So very elegant construction which allows to estimate this Pancharatnam Berry phase. So what happens in our experiment? When we have exciton condensation, then we have long-range coherent spin precession in indirect exciton condensate. When you have precession, which means motion on this Poincaré sphere. And in fact, this precession has very short period, which we calculated here. So it also has long period. So like if you look here, you can see what this is more blue, this is more yellow, and overall this makes the pattern which I showed you earlier. So this slow long length component gives us polarization pattern. So like if this is more blue, this is more yellow, this is vortex of polarization. But you also have this short length fast component. And this fast component, it just goes, each period here corresponds to one motion on the Poincaré sphere. So this coherent spin precession gives you permanently acquired phase, which we actually observed in the experiment, this Pancharatnam Berry phase. And now you can use this figure to estimate, like using this equation, how much phase is acquired. Okay, so we calculated motion on the Poincaré sphere. We calculated how much phase is acquired. Now, of course, momentum which associated with phase is phase acquired divided by the length of the cycle. We compare it with what we measured, and we are in a good agreement. Of course, not perfectly good, but it's, of course, oversimplified theory, no interaction, no damping, but it's in a good agreement. And what is the practical significance? You see, after the phase appeared, it doesn't decay, which means what this coherence precession doesn't decay, which means you have very long range coherent spin transport. If you wish, dream of spintronics, very long coherent spin transport. So it's realized in the exciton condensate. So now let me switch to next topic, excitonic devices. I will tell you only a few words about this. So indirect excitons have a built-in dipole moment. Like an electron is in this quantum well, a hole is in this quantum well, so we are separated by D, and this D is fixed. So we are fixed dipoles. Then this is very good because, first of all, we can control energy of these indirect excitons by voltage. When we apply voltage, we control energy of indirect excitons. So change in energy is simply dipole moment times applied electric field. And this is experimental data. So it's nice and convenient way to control exciton energy. So now you can apply electrodes on the surface of the sample. Apply different voltages to these electrodes. And you obtain any desired in-plane potential landscape for excitons. And we are using it for two applications. One is circuit devices, like we realize transistors, diodes, excitonic CCD, memory cells, everything works nicely. So why do we need this? So excitons, signal processing can be low energy signal processing. Like, because excitons are bosons, in comparison to electrons, where thermal tails are suppressed, where you need smaller voltage to switch transistor between on and off. So it can be low energy signal processing with excitons in comparison to electrons. Next, our signal communication is done by photons, but signal processing is done by electrons. Electrons cannot transform to photons. You need to build interconnects, and this takes energy and time. In contrast to that, excitons can directly transform to photons, where for interconnects are very simple, fast, and energy efficient. So it's seamless coupled to optical communication. And comparison to photonics, like footprints can be very small as for electronic devices, because for photons it's limited by wavelength for photons, and in fact, it's much bigger than that, because it's hard to control photons. But for excitons, we are limited by exciton Bohr radius and thermal de Broglie wavelength, which can be much smaller than for photons, as small as for electrons. Okay, so I will not present this. Chelsea will tell you something about excitonic devices at our poster. And of course, if you are interested, we will be happy to answer questions. I will tell a few words about basic studies, how we use these principles to study excitons in a variety of devices. So we study excitons in traps and in lattices. So first, traps. So we made this electrode on the surface of the sample, and the shape of electrode is calculated so to provide parabolic confinement of excitons. So like this is shape of the trap created by such electrodes. In X direction it makes like that, in Y direction it makes like that. So it's parabolic like trap. And then we study Bose-Einstein condensation of excitons in this trap. Like in higher temperatures, we have classical exciton gas, which is distributed over the entire trap. When we low temperature, excitons condense to the ground state. So we condense to the ground state. To verify if this is a condensate, so we again do shift interferometry experiments. And we see that at higher temperature, we don't have spontaneous coherence. But when we reduce temperature, spontaneous coherence appears in the system. And if you plot coherence length as a function of temperature, at higher temperature is simply point spread function, so just determined by the objective. But at low temperatures, the entire exciton cloud is coherent. It's as good as you can get for a condensate. Everything is coherent. So then we actually performed some theory recently. So theory just takes this shape as a basis. And when we include interaction between excitons, you know what indirect excitons are dipoles. So here minuses, here pluses. They repel each other. So due to this, we screen this trap. And we obtain screen potential profile of the trap. We also included not simply mean field interaction between excitons, but also correlations. In a second, I will tell you what are these correlations and how we measure correlations in the condensate. So, and after we took everything into account, we obtained good agreement between experiment and theory. Good agreement means what condensation takes place at the temperature, which is the same for experimental measurements and calculated by the theory, which takes screening into account. I will not go into detail, but after all, everything was published. Okay, so next topic, lattices. So we also create potential profiles. We can create any potential profile. So here we create periodic lattices. So we made a pattern of electrodes, apply voltage to these electrodes. This way we obtain a lattice. Like for this example, it's a rectangular lattice for indirect excitons. And what is nice about this lattice, we can control the amplitude of this lattice in situ just by changing voltage, which we apply. So very simple, similar to optical lattices for atoms. But here, in place of control by light, we control lattice by voltage. And now we can measure this diagram where excitons are localized, where we were excited, we stay. Or if we are delocalized, if we travel across the lattice.
How far below the structure of
the exciton? So this is 1 micron above these excitons. And the potential profile, of course, is calculated at the location of excitons. So why we put this lattice 1 micron above the excitons? Because at every edge of the electrode, we have fringent electric field. In gallium arsenide, excitons have relatively small binding energy. So therefore, to we located coupled quantum well with indirect excitons 1 micron away from the lattice to reduce fringent electric field. By this location, we reduce it considerably. We simply calculated where modulation of energy is already is still big, but fringent electric field is suppressed so that it does not dissociate excitons. And then everything works nicely. Yes, yes, yes. Like here we apply one voltage, here we apply another voltage. And then it creates this pattern.
Okay, and ground is just your...
Yes, and ground is, we used doped gallium arsenide as a bottom homogeneous electrode. So on the top we have shaped electrode, at the bottom we have homogeneous electrode, and coupled quantum well is in between. Right.
Then you're doing something different, right?
If it is gallium arsenide, very similar. So if it's gallium arsenide, very similar. So for all devices, I did not plot it here. For all devices which we do with gallium arsenide, it's similar. It's bottom is homogeneous electrode. Then you have coupled quantum well. And on the top we have electrodes for the circuit, like for a transistor, for example, or for a lattice, or for a trap. So they are all very similar. In gallium arsenide, we need to be sure what our fringed electric field doesn't kill indirect excitons. When I will show you TMD in a few slides, it's much more easy because bonding energy in TMD is huge. You don't need to take care about this fringed electric field. But in gallium arsenide, you need. They are gentle. Okay, so here we directly measure this vocalization-devocalization transition. And again, we use what fact, what when excitons emit light, we convey all information. So we know where we are. Of course, only small fraction of excitons transforms to photons, but we know where we are. And we know if we are just where we excited them by the laser, so we are localized. But if we excited them here, but we are everywhere, we are delocalized. So we can measure vocalization-devocalization transition. Like for electrons, we call it metal insulator transition. We just use vocalization-devocalization, but because after all, it's transport of neutral particles anyway. Okay, and then this is this diagram which we obtained. So here lattice amplitude, so we control in situ lattice amplitude. Here is interaction strength. We measure the interaction strength just by measuring spectroscopy. Okay, and it appears. At high lattice amplitude, this transition between localized and delocalized, it's more or less expected. When interaction strength becomes comparable to the lattice amplitude. Well, in atoms, people observe something very similar. When interaction strength is comparable to lattice amplitude. When we go to zero lattice amplitude, we still need finite interaction to have localization-delocalization transition. And this is due to random potential. Because even at zero lattice amplitude, we have random potential, and we need finite interaction comparable to the random potential to cause localization-delocalization transition. Okay, correlations. We use the same lattices to measure correlations. So a few words about correlations. So for uncorrelated gas, you have like distributed positive charge, distributed negative charge. Like electrons and holes are actually everywhere. Then interaction in this system is determined by so-called plate capacitor formula. You see, it looks like a plate capacitor. It's very easy to determine. It's also called mean field approximation. So it's easy to determine the energy shift for some density. In real life, of course, we have correlations because excitons repel each other. We try to keep as far away from each other as possible. So therefore, you don't have this homogeneous density. In fact, you have some correlation function. In the limit of the most strong correlations, you have a dipole crystal. When excitons are as far away as possible in principle for this density, then this correlation function looks like that, and interaction energy in such correlated system, of course, is much smaller than mean field, simply because you don't have excitons next to each other. We try to keep far away from each other. Even if you don't have a crystal, for any gas or liquid, you have correlations, you have suppression of density of particles next to each other, so you have some correlation function. So therefore, interaction in real system is smaller than this plate capacitor formula. Then how to measure correlations in the system? So we use the same lattice, which was shown here, to measure correlations of the system. So the basic idea is that the same interaction which determines energy shift of excitons also determines their ability to screen the lattice. So where we measure two parameters, energy shift of excitons and how we screen the lattice. So we know amplitude of unscreened lattice, and when we know how much it reduces after screening. From this, we determine both density of excitons and the strength of correlation. And it appeared, when we measured it, that we have strong correlations in exciton system. At low densities, correlations are as strong that this formula is corrected by 10 times. At high densities, correlation becomes weaker. So this formula becomes almost not corrected. So correlations is a function of density. And finally, excitons and TMD structures. So gallium arsenide is, of course, a good system. It's the most clean system people developed. most clean material system. I'm not talking about atoms, but for materials, gallium arsenide is the most clean system. It's a nice system to develop concepts, to understand everything. However, binding energy of excitons in gallium arsenide is small. Therefore, you cannot build excitonic devices operated at higher temperatures. So the record temperature we achieved for excitonic transistor in gallium arsenide, actually it was aluminum arsenide, was 100 Kelvin. But of course, we want everything working at room temperature. So for that, we developed these TMD structures. So here, like this is one of the examples. People are working with different kinds of TMD structures. So here we have, in place of gallium arsenide, we have MOS2. In place of aluminum gallium arsenide, we have HBN. And when the band structure is the same as for gallium arsenide, the only difference, what binding energy of such indirect exciton is two orders of magnitude larger than in gallium arsenide. So it's very high binding energy. So therefore, these devices built with excitons in TMD should be able easily to operate at room temperature, or even twice or three times larger than room temperature, due to very high binding energy. So this is one of the directions. So we want to develop all these excitonic devices, which we demonstrated in gallium arsenide. Now we want them working at room temperature in TMD. Second, even condensation in TMD should occur at much higher temperatures. Why is that? So this is temperature of quantum degeneracy, which I showed on the first slide. Now let me just regroup the terms by doing nothing, simply regroup the terms. Now what I have, so this is something on the order of one. So this is binding energy of excitons, and this is density time Bohr radius squared. So this number, when I increase density, can go only up to some point, because then we will have a mod transition from excitons to metallic electron hole plasma. So therefore, this can have maximum, actually calculated by different theories to be roughly like that. So you see, the critical temperature for condensation or quantum degeneracy is simply proportional to binding energy of excitons. So therefore, if you have binding energy two orders of magnitude bigger, then condensation temperature should be also two orders of magnitude bigger. So this is why we will also try to study condensation in these materials. So what do we have so far? So far, very recently, we already made several attempts. Like a year ago, we published a paper where we did not succeed in realization of indirect excitons. But now, eventually, it worked. So we published it a month ago, less than a month ago. So here we modified design. So this is already modified design. So we played with layer thickness, with growing parameters. So it's all grown by the group of Andrei Geim in Manchester. And now we realized indirect excitons at room temperature. So we checked all characteristics of indirect excitons, so long lifetime. So lifetime is four orders of magnitude longer than regular direct exciton. So it's a relatively long lifetime. And if you make pulses of laser, so laser pulse, no laser pulse, if you measure during the laser pulse, spectrum is dominated by direct exciton. If you measure between laser pulses, spectrum is dominated by indirect exciton. If you measure something like that, you see both indirect exciton and direct exciton. So then indirect exciton have built-in dipole moment. So we are controlled by voltage. And we verified it here. Everything is at room temperature. We apply voltage. We control energy of indirect excitons. And finally, indirect exciton should show transport because we have longer lifetime. And we observe transport at room temperature for indirect exciton. So far, not very impressive. So we travel only a few micrometers, but it's just a start. So quality of TMD is permanently improving. So we right now we are working on the quality. It's we always modifying design of the samples, trying with some feedback, with the sample growth. This is work in progress. But what is good, indirect excitons are already observed at room temperature, and we work as planned. So this is summary of my talk. So I covered these topics, and please come to the poster of Chelsea. Chelsea will present more topics which I did not cover in this talk. Thank you.